So what they, good morning, of course. So I'm Fred Truyen from Leuven University in Belgium, and I'm also the president of Photo Consortium, which is a provider to Europeana, an aggregator for photographic content, and is a membership association for archives, photo archives mainly. Now in Europeana space, we do a photography pilot, that's one thing. But with all the pilots, we are also working on an educational portal where we will have our demonstrators, the outputs of the pilots brought together in a more in a format more adapted to educational practices. And one small part of that is the MOOC project that we will be doing, and I will talk about that. Now, I used an image from one of our pilots that, to me, summarizes it all. It's from the open and hybrid publishing pilot, and they talk about our project as read, explore, remix, share, and I think this is eSpace to the core. So I use this image as an intro, and in the six pilots, this is what we have been doing, that is exploring how we can creatively reuse cultural content and more so stimulate both professionals as well as the general public to become creative contributors to this new economy. And so our idea is that taking insights from pilots like the TV pilot, the museums pilot, where we have a whole toolbox for museums to use, the dance pilot. Specifically for the museums, we are doing at this moment even an experiment in a museum nearby where we are using the Blinkster app to have really interaction with these museums. So you see, we did a lot of activities here, open and hybrid publishing again with an open book, a games pilot, photography, etc. So all these materials are now, they have been produced in the project, and now we need to do the important part, that is getting people on board, getting people to use it. And through our Europeana space with environment, people will also learn to connect to the Europeana APIs, to the Europeana labs, so we want to reach out. We also have dedicated educational demonstrators that we will integrate, and of course, you know one of them very well. It's about the Rode Altaar in the back of this magnificent museum. And similarly here about the work of Van Eyck in Belgium. Now, what are the goals of a MOOC and why do we choose a MOOC? There is a very big difference between putting a website online where people can browse educational materials and when they like it, they can use it. This is not sufficient when you need real learning, when you really want to transform the way people act and make them more proactive users, you need a time investment. And typically a course or a university course is a sizable time investment by people to learn things. And that is why we thought, hey, why don't we make with the materials that we built in these educational demonstrators, in the pilots, a real course, an academic course, so to say, but targeting different groups. So the whole idea is that in one course, you will have three communities. You will have a more general public with an interest in cultural heritage. And within that group, we are targeting specifically teachers and students. Because people always forget that for Europeana, for example, this is one of the first audiences. Europeana is very, very much used in education. And we hear a lot about new business models, but there is already a real business model of Europeana in schools, in higher education, where these materials are being used. And so we would like teachers to learn how they can write their own stories using content from Europeana and using your cultural heritage content. To give you one example that I always repeat because it's such a good one, when I studied history, the whole Baltic region was just a red blurb on the map. It was the USSR somewhere. It was behind the curtain. We didn't learn anything about it, nothing at all, nothing. I checked it. I have still my books from school. We didn't even know there was something like the Baltic Sea. It wasn't taught. Well, this totally new reality of Europe needs to be in the classes now. And it isn't there. I checked the school book of my daughter, and still there is no chapter about the whole history of the Baltics. Well, we can write it, because now on Europeana, any teacher can find materials that we put online there from several archives, reaching from Estonia to Slovakia to Bulgaria to Poland, etc. So the material is there. Now we need the stories. And teachers should take the lead and start using this. But there is also the professionals in the creative industries, but also in the archives, in the glam sector, in the museums. Our experience is that for a small organization, a small archive, you only need one savvy person to change your way of work. Hire a young person that for once is not a content specialist, but is a creative tool user. Is someone who can work with a computer, who knows the internet, who knows social media, and you will develop activities that will allow you to generate an income stream that will allow you again to hire content specialists. But do it now, you only need one. There are a lot of very dynamic SMEs in any country in Europe that can help you out. So the only thing that you need is in your organization someone who is the motor of change, and we are targeting them in this course. And of course you have the professional developers. There for us it is easy, we will just put all the materials, the APIs, the software that we have developed, the documentation in the MOOC for these people. Now, what we will use a typical MOOC platform like edX. edX is an open platform that is used by very large universities. But we will publish the content in an open way so that you can integrate it in your own platforms, in your own university systems, etc. So it will be a share-alike idea. Here an example of such a MOOC platform, KU Leuvenix, where we publish our MOOCs. We have one now on the Great War and philosophy. It is still the case that in the heydays of the MOOCs in 2012, 2013, you had 40,000, 50,000 students registering for a MOOC. Today it's about 15,000 to 20,000, but it's still an enormous number of people that you reach, of which about 1,500 to 2,000 really follow the whole course, which is still larger than what you have in your university. So there is certainly a big reach out to be done. Now we will offer this e-space on that platform. The whole idea is that each pilot will have one module of a couple of hours, and that during a week you will be able to learn one module and to do something with it. Each module contains some preparatory readings, some lectures or video clips, instructive videos on how to do things. There will be maybe a small questionnaire, a quiz, and there will be a kind of assignment, something to do. And the assignment is very straightforward. In this MOOC, you will learn how to use the WIT environment, the things that we developed, You will learn how to publish your own open book. You will learn how to organize a bring your own photos event in your archive. You will learn to do everything that we did in the pilots. And we will detail what steps are needed. For example, you will understand how a museum can get in touch with the right SME to digitize their masterpieces and what it involves. And this you can learn from our demonstrators. And you will have group activities. So you will interact with other learners. And the fact that there are three cohorts, the students, the professionals, and the developers, will always also allow you to have a sneak peek in the other groups and to make a step to another world. And to, as a GLEM professional, for example, to have a look at what the developers are talking about, etc. That's the idea. So again, an overview of what you could find there. We think to have a first launch of the MOOC in October 2016. And so it will be an iterative MOOC that will run each semester or each year, dependingly. Typically, it has such kind of course outline with then video clips and some lectures. Here, we took information from the photography pilot with some introduction about photo archives, some links to further preparatory reading. And then you have the application that we built, and it is explained how you can start using it. So what we really want to do is to learn teachers how they can use content that we published on Europeana to tell stories to their students. And any teacher can do so. And for example, here we made some example stories. So I'm not lying. A teacher will produce something exactly like that. This is within reach. It's not, I have to be a professional to do this. No, no, the teacher will be able to do that, exactly that. And you can imagine that it is another learning experience for the students to have a teacher who does things like that. We will learn you how to organize workshops, memories workshops. How you, for example, when you invite people to bring their family photos to your archive, what kind of documents should you provide? What kind of information? Should these people sign off something? What kind of metadata do you need, etc.? That will all be explained. And so you see that there are forum discussions for each group foreseen in each module. And then we will have, I now put it here in our demo module, but there will be a separate module all about IPR and creativity. And the discussion about privacy, cultural rights will have its place in a kind of legal section, which will make the MOOC very interesting for professionals also, so that they can get up to speed with the latest information about orphan works, for example, or about Europeana labels and how to apply them, etc. Okay, so I hope that you try to keep informed through our website and through our communication channel, Digital Meets Culture. You will find indications of that on the rollouts there. And see you in October in the MOOC, I would say. And let's start becoming creative reusers of cultural heritage. Thank you.
Thank you, Fred. It was interesting presentation. Quick question about MOOC. What do you think it's, by your experience, is the MOOC learning instrument or a social cultural instrument? What do you think?
Well, I think when MOOCs were a hype in 2011, late 2011, 2012, there was a lot of concern that these MOOCs were a kind of commodification of learning, and that it was a kind of Barnum way to sell educational content. This is not the way it worked out. You have an advertising part, and when you reach 20,000 people, you are not planning to really teach to 20,000 people. It are 20,000 people who got a contact, a positive contact with your organization. It's about the 1,500 to 2,500 learners that you find. And I think that the MOOC community has realized that it is important to, within this group of students that come from anywhere, because there is no prerequisite, that you need to build communities and cohorts. That's also the reason why we will divide our MOOC in three groups, so that you, as a professional, for example, you will be with peers, and you will interact with a community of like-minded people who have a similar background. And so there is a lot of work now in the MOOC development to support and build these social communities of learning. And this will be the true motor of learning. I think that it is also the reason why we want to do a MOOC, because we believe that changing the creative, the cultural heritage practice is a long-term effect. It's building communities that have another attitude towards culture, a more proactive attitude.
Thank you. One quick question maybe someone has. I don't see any hands. Anyway, thank you, Fred. And